Now, in the case of songbirds, which is what I work on as a model organism, some of the things that are really highlighted by songbirds that are relevant to humans certainly are, for example, the ability to communicate through learned vocal signals. Songbirds learn to sing by listening to a tutor when they're an infant or a juvenile bird, and they listen to their adult tutors, and they gradually come to copy the sounds that their adults make. And in fact, this process of vocal imitation really has no other parallel in the animal kingdom other than human beings. Mm-hmm. And so if you were looking for a model for how does a human being learn to communicate through language and so forth, there is no better animal model of that than a songbird. Now, songbirds also have other features as well that have made them into an interesting model organism. They have these very distinctive differences between males and females. The sex differences in the brain have been a focus of a lot of research. Again, we think that this is highlighting something that is relevant to humans, but that is especially drawn in stark contrast in the songbird. Now, because it's an experimental model organism, we can, you know, go in and we can take measurements in the brain of a living songbird, which makes it again a powerful experimental organism. In fact, this little diagram back here shows a work that we're doing here at the Beckman to try to enhance our ability to monitor what's going on in the brain of a living bird as he sings or as he listens to song. You see, this is a little zebra finch here, and this is his beak and his eye. But this whole apparatus here is a little helmet that we have constructed. We actually do it with a three-dimensional printer that lays down this composite resin in layers. And so we use computer automated design to kind of fit this thing. And the whole purpose of this really is to actually allow us then to use this as an anchoring point to attach fiber optic cables that then are used to send and receive light signals into and out of the brain. And in work that we're doing in collaboration with Gabriella Gritton and Monica Fabiani here at the Beckman, we are analyzing these light signals to gain insight into what's happening inside the brain while a bird is wide awake, potentially, and even ideally while the bird is interacting and singing and listening to songs. So it's the ability to do these kinds of manipulations and then to relate it to things that we know about the anatomy inside the head and the genes that are expressed in the head, things that we can study invasively in the songbird, but we can also make that bridge back to humans through these non-invasive kinds of techniques, and hopefully develop measurements and so forth that may have applicability to processes that are going on in the human brain. So, in the case of the FMRP or the Fragile X mental retardation protein story, that's a gene that has been implicated, as the name says, in mental retardation. But we don't really understand necessarily the mechanisms by which it causes us. One of the other symptoms of the disorder in humans is a major disruption of the ability to speak. And so investigators, as we have developed the kind of genetic and genomic tools for the zebrafinch as a model organism, it's now become possible to ask whether or not that same gene, the fragile X mental retardation protein gene, whether or not that same gene might also be having a role in the development and function of the songbird's nervous system that's controlling this property of vocal learning and vocal communication. And so Stephanie Seaman here at Illinois and in the Beckman Group has led a project to try to identify the songbird or the zebrafinch version of the fragile X gene, the FMRP gene, and she has been successful at that. So the vision there is that ultimately we, again, may be able to take advantage of the model organism properties of the zebrafinch to study both what might how a disruption of FMRP gene, how that might lead to a disruption of speech and communication and so forth, and potentially also what we might be able to do to fix that disruption. So, for example, the idea would be that we can now, we're in a position to target the FMRP gene and to try to disrupt it using genetic techniques and so forth in the zebrafinch, and then to see whether or not this does disrupt the process of vocal communication and vocal learning. In two other cases, we and other colleagues have done this kinds of thing, sort of proof of concept, and have shown that if you disrupt certain key targeted molecules in a system, the bird does not learn to sing properly. One of the big things, of course, that we've learned from studying, I think, the songbird is that it's not just one gene. And so there are, as I mentioned a minute ago, when a bird hears a song, we spent 15 years studying one gene because we found that this one gene gets turned on and gets turned off when a bird hears a novel song. More recently now, using more kind of high technology approaches of modern genomics, we're finding there's hundreds of genes that are being turned on and off. So part of the challenge for us, I think, right now is to how to deal with this problem of complexity. When we're looking at a complex nervous system, a complex genome, many different interacting components, and yet at the end of the day, maybe what we care about is a mental retardation or a loss of brain tissue in aging and degeneration and so forth. You know, we're trying to connect the dots between all these complex things and these very simple, immediate kind of problems that, you know, humans can experience is kind of our challenge. I think the Beckman Institute, again, has a long history of trying to confront this problem of complexity in biology. And so this is a good environment for thinking about those problems. Well, obviously, it would be enormously gratifying. When I started into science, I was weighing whether to go into medicine per se or into research, and I made the decision that I really wanted to do research. But it has always been motivated by a sense of social responsibility and so forth. And so, some of the questions that motivate us are pure intellectual curiosity about how the world works. But, I mean, there's, absolutely no question that there would be nothing that would make me happier than to see useful applications come of this. And certainly, my own research has been supported now for 20 years by the National Institutes of Health, the NIH. And so I feel I have a big debt to repay, if you will. And like everyone, I have friends and family, who have suffered from Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease and psychiatric problems and so forth. And so this certainly is the context in which the work really is centered. So.
Okay.